So the first lecture of this lecture series will be delivered by Professor Athanase Papadopoulos. So I think there's no need of introduction. So now I request Professor Athanase to please deliver the first talk.
Okay. Thank you very much. So I will be giving five hours of lectures here. I will start from very basic material, which I assume everybody will understand easily. The last two lectures will be a little bit more specialized, and in the meanwhile, you will have acquired, I mean, I'm talking to the students, right? You will have acquired some experience and some notions of the vocabulary which I will use in the last two lectures. My subject is what? So my subject is Finsler geometry, which is the subject of this school, and my main aim is to give examples of Finsler manifolds. Yes. Okay. Thank you. So among these, I will give a list of these. I cannot change anything. Ah, it's good. Okay, thank you. So I will give a list of the of these examples, and then I will develop them more. So while Finsler examples, for the time being, it's examples of metric spaces. And then we will talk about Finsler. Okay, we shall talk about we shall use the Euclidean plane with its usual metric. This is one of the most important metrics because we are used to it, and because my other metrics will use this metric. There will be an underlying metric, which is this one. I shall talk about the sphere, the metric on the sphere. I shall talk about the hyperbolic metric. Or the hyperbolic space in dimension 3 or more. Mainly we'll be interested in dimension 2, but I will also talk about the other dimensions. So let me just make the list now, and then I will talk a little bit more about the examples. I will talk about something called I will mention this metric called the weak. Semi-hyperbolic metric. I will explain the name. I will talk about the Funk metric. Today I will explain to you what is this Funk metric. I will talk about the Hilbert metric. Which is more familiar than the Funk metric to those who know a little bit. I will talk about something called the semi-Apollonian metric, which is also a metric I like very much. The word semi-Apollonian, well, the word Apollonian comes from the fact that it uses very much circles. You know that Apollonius is a mathematician who worked about 2,000 years ago on conics, in fact. Conics, which are the intersections of a plane with a cone. So you have circles, you have ellipses, you have hyperbolas, you have parabolas, and so on. And in this kind of metric, the circles and the ellipses and so on play a lot of they have a large role. It's a metric where roughly speaking, the circles play the role of geodesics. And this is why it's called Apollonian. So my predecessor here, the professor in medicine, mentioned the word geodesic metric. All of these are examples of geodesic metrics. I will explain what it is. So he said that he doesn't know anything about geodesic geometry, but in fact, it's fine. Of course, he's a doctor. He's not a mathematician. But for you, a geodesic is just a shortest path between two points. And these shortest paths for the semi-Apollonian metric are, instead of being the straight lines of Euclidean geometry, are circles. Then I will talk about something which I called time-like versions. Well, we have time-like versions of several of these metrics. The word time-like refers to the geometry which underlines the general relativity. You know that the general relativity is has an underlying space, which is the space-time, which we call space-time. And there's a geometry which is very strange, in fact, where, for instance, to go from one place to another, you must take the longest path and not the shortest path. The inequalities, the usual inequalities in analysis, for instance, the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality in this time-like geometry, it's in the other way around. For instance, the triangle inequality, the usual triangle inequality in the time-like version, it's in the other way around. The distance between A and B is greater than the distance between A and C plus the distance between C and B, and so on. So you see, in mathematics, we make sometimes definitions. Then we study the consequences of these definitions. Everybody can make any kind of definition. I mean, and then you develop. The important thing is that you prove some theorems which are interesting, in fact, which people find interesting. In this definition of time-like geometry, I think it's interesting for mathematicians, but it also underlines the physics of relativity theory. So I will talk also about. I will talk at the last in the last two lectures about something which is called the first and. Metric on Dijkmuller space. This is my initial motivation for studies all these strange metrics. I was interested in this thing called the first metric on Dijkmuller space. This involves some hyperbolic geometry which several of my colleagues will talk about. This is why I'm leaving this to the end, the last 2 days. And so when I, while I was working on this, it's a kind of, sophisticated, but very, very basic and very beautiful geometry. I searched for examples of metric spaces which satisfy some of the properties that this matrix satisfies. So I started studying this one. I started studying the Funk metric, the Hilbert metric, the semi-Apollonian metric. This time-like geometry came later, but it's also related. In fact, all these metrics are related. Let me start by giving a definition so that you have an example to start with, and then I will tell you what are the main problems. I will give you some of the propositions. So I will start with this just the definition of this semi-quasi hyperbolic metric. So you have a domain, say, and let's draw it like this. This is a domain A in the Euclidean plane. It could be in higher dimensions, but all the important things you can just write them. You can just try to understand them in the plane. It's already depressing. And then you want to define the distance, a distance between two points, x and y. So I call this, I use this notation, that this is I sub a, the distance between x and y. So this is the logarithm of 1 plus when I write this like this, x and x minus y between two bars, this means the Euclidean distance. This is Euclidean distance divided by the distance from x to the boundary. So here, what is here, this curve here, this is the boundary of A. Yes, right. This is here, absolute value of x minus y. This denotes the Euclidean distance. This is why I said that the Euclidean distance will play always a role in this metric. So it turns out that this metric is, okay, so the first thing, So here I have the word semi, which will disappear later. But what does it mean, semi? First of all, what is a metric? What is a metric? So I have a few properties which I want to. One of them, let us call it D, a metric D. One of them is that this, which I consider as the distance from x to y, I want it to be non-negative. I want the distance from x to x, the distance from a point to itself, to be zero. And then I want this triangle inequality to hold. This distance from x to y is always less than distance from x to z plus distance from z to y. And that's it. I do not require that the distance from x to y is equal to the distance from y to x. this is a general fact which is usually, in Finsler geometry, you don't assume, you usually do not assume that the metric is symmetric. If you are not familiar with this, you must believe that this is an unnecessary condition. If you are familiar with Finsler geometry, then you know that this condition is not required. So this is the usual definition of a metric that we have in undergraduate mathematics, except that I don't assume this. I don't know why I reserved this square here. I don't know what I wanted to say. Maybe that this is sometimes the use of this word semi. The other metrics are also semi, but then I will not use this terminology. I will not need it. I will tell you more about this. But right now I can always when you have such a metric, one good question is, well, to study the symmetrization of this metric. The symmetrization of D, for instance, the symmetrization of this semi-quasi-hyperbolic metric. So you must add. So let me tell you what is the symmetrization. In fact, there are many ways to symmetrize a metric, and I will focus on two ways, which are the most simple ways, how to symmetrize. How to symmetrize a metric, how to make it symmetric. As I said, there are infinite number of ways, but the most usual ones are this one, which I denoted by S. You have S d of xy. This is 1/2 of the distance from x to y plus the distance from y to x. So you take the arithmetic symmetrization, just the sum of the distance from x to y, the distance from y to x. There's also another one which is also important in the applications, which this is sigma. This is, you take the maximum of the distance between x and y, and the distance between y and x. This is another kind of symmetrization. And then all the questions that we address for this metric here, you can then address them for the symmetrizations. And it turns out that there are important applications. You see, let me say a few words about this one. So there are, this metric is where is my this metric semi quasi hyperbolic So let me just mention, since I talk about symmetrization, so this is SIA, this arithmetic symmetrization. This has a name, in fact. What is the name? Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is studied. In fact, it has a name, but it's not important. That's studied in the context this is uniform domains in Rn. All the definitions can be. I mean, the same definition works in Rn, and this is work of Gehring. And Osgood. It's easy to find this reference. When a reference is easy to find, then I don't give it. So you just Google uniform domains of Gehring and Osgood, and you find the references. Okay, and then it's other symmetrization, sigma d. This is studied by. This is studied by. In the context of conformal geometry and quasi conformal mappings. I don't know if somebody here will talk about this. The name quasi-hyperbolic now, the name quasi-hyperbolic comes for several reasons. One reason is that you see, when you have a metric, when you define a metric like this, then you want to relate it to the familiar metrics which we have. You want to relate it to the familiar metrics. So for instance, I consider that the hyperbolic metric, say on the upper, the hyperbolic metric on the upper half plane of hyperbolic geometry. This is upper half plane of hyperbolic geometry. This is also called the Poincaré model. So this is a well studied metric, and one of the aims, what I want to say is that this metric turns out in these works that it's quasi isometric to this hyperbolic metric. Let me recall the hyperbolic metric, and then you will see why. You will see why you will see also why there's such a factor in this formula. So yes, sure. Yes, you are right. Sigma I D I A. Yes. Yes. Thank you very much. Yes. So. Let me say a few words about this metric. So you have the upper half plane. This is the upper half plane. So this is, say, the set of x, y, such that y is positive. It's here. And there are several ways of defining a metric on this upper half plane, which gives the hyperbolic metric. One of them is important. Let me write it. Let me write a formula here. And it is close. It will make us closer to the Finsler geometry. So. You define a length element, so this is length element, infinitesimal length element, or the square of the infinitesimal length element. In Euclidean geometry, the length element, as you know, is dx square plus dy square. This is the infinitesimal length element in Euclidean geometry. What does this mean? It means that when you have a curve gamma, from an interval into the Euclidean plane, say if gamma is a differentiable curve, okay? So I write gamma of t x of t y of t in coordinates, then I can define the lengths of gamma. Every curve has a length in Euclidean geometry using this infinitesimal length element. So this is infinitesimal length element. So to find the length of the curve, I just integrate the infinitesimal length element. So I get integral from A to B of square root x squared of t plus y squared of t dt. This is the length of gamma, right? Is this correct?
Right.
Thank you very much. Now the infinitesimal length element for the upper half plane, you divide this by y squared. This is the infinitesimal length element for hyperbolic space. This is the usual. This is one of the useful forms of hyperbolic metric, of hyperbolic geometry. So y square, so my point is here. This is the infinitesimal length element at this point. You are dividing by the square of the distance. Y square is the distance to the boundary of this space. Okay, so in fact, this is the square of the infinitesimal element. If I want the infinitesimal element and not its square, so I write this as ds, and here I put a square root, and here I remove the square sign, and it appears the distance to the boundary of my space, which is where this factor here comes from. Okay. This is non-symmetric, so we forget about this non-symmetric for now. But there's a symmetric version which I mentioned here, but I erased it. There are two symmetric versions, but one of the versions, when you symmetrize this, and when your open set omega is the upper half space, you get exactly the hyperbolic metric. This is why it's called semi-hyperbolic. And the term, quasi-hyperbolic comes later. But you see, so everything I wanted to mention with all this is that with some of the metrics, the distance to the boundary is an important factor. You see, and when the point becomes very, very close to the boundary, then this ratio here becomes very large. This ratio becomes very large because the denominator is becoming very small. So this, the length element is becoming very large when I approach the boundary. And then the boundary, instead of being something here, as you see in the Euclidean metric, in the metric itself, the boundary becomes something like very far away. It becomes infinitely far away, because the length element is the distances, the distance from a point to a sequence of points which are converging to a point at infinity goes to infinity. Okay, and this is a very interesting property that I'm defining a metric where this curve which I see here with my eyes becomes at infinity. I don't see it anymore, and it becomes the boundary at infinity of my space. So you can study all these kinds of additional structures which you can additional questions which you have is the structure of the boundary at infinity, and this makes the relation with the talks of Besson and Courtois, which will talk to you about structures of metric spaces at infinity. They will talk about hyperbolic, Gromov hyperbolic spaces, and there are good questions about whether this metric here on this set is Gromov hyperbolic or not. So of course I'm dealing with a non-symmetric metric, as I said, but I don't know if they will deal with non-symmetric metrics. No, he says no, but there are questions of, I mean, all the good questions for symmetric metrics, you can ask them for non-symmetric metrics, or you can just symmetrize by one of the two procedures I told you, and then ask the questions for the symmetrized metrics. Not only for this one, but for the other ones also. Every time I have to justify a little bit the study of non-symmetric metrics. For the justification is that there are examples which are interesting with good questions. I will tell you what kind of questions. But non-symmetric metrics, as I said, they appear naturally in everyday life. Fersten says, and Busemann says, and all these people who study non-symmetric metrics, the same thing. Imagine there's a hill and you are down, and then there's a point up on the hill. It's natural to think that the distance from the down to the upper point is greater than the distance from the point on the up of the hill until this one, right? It takes you a lot of much more effort to go from this point to this point than from this point to this point. So it's natural to define a kind of a distance, and there are many distances which you can define between this point and this point, which takes into account this what I just said. So this is why non-symmetric metrics are important. So what are the questions now? What are the questions that we want to address? What kind of questions we want to address? So, one of the questions is. For this metric, I think nobody studied this question. So if there is somebody, a student or whatever, yes? You mean for the triangle inequality? Yeah. This is your question? Yeah. Yes, it's, I leave it as an exercise. This is exercise for those who want to do it for tomorrow, for instance. For every x, y, and z in A, I have y is less or equal to I, sorry, less than a, oh no, it's okay, xz plus ia of zy. Yes, this is satisfying. You must write a couple of lines or three lines to prove this. Okay? No, I don't think you need convexity. No. I don't think you, you just, you see that first you transform a little bit, in a little bit better this thing, and then you end up here with using the property of the multiplicative property of the logarithm, you know, the logarithm of a plus logarithm of b is equal to logarithm of a times b, and then you do something. It needs. I mean, there is a trick in here. It needs something, but this is true. This is true for any x, y, and z. You see, for some points, you have x distance. I mean, distance from x, y is equal to distance from x, z to distance from z to y. And this is what I was talking about the geodesics. Let me say that a line gamma from A, B. My space E. This is the definition. Now I'm recalling the definition of a geodesic. Is a geodesic if for every, let's call them X, Y, and Z in AB satisfying what? Satisfying x less than y less than d, I have distance. I didn't put it in the right order. I want to put it in the order I use there. X, z, and y. I have this distance from x, y is equal to distance from x, z plus distance from z to y. So a geodesic is just an arc in your space, the image of an interval, where every time you take three points in the right order, the triangle inequality, instead of being an inequality, like there, it is an equality. This is what we expect from a geodesic. In fact, the geodesics of a curve in the plane is a geodesic in the sense that it's a straight line as we define it. A curve is a curve in the plane, or a wiggled curve like this, here a curve. It is a geodesic, that is, it is a straight line. If and only if this relation is satisfied for any three points in the space. So I come back to my question here. I raised it. But yes. Thank you very much. Yes. It is very correct, and I'm glad that here. So this is d of gamma of x. Even here. Yes, you're right. D of gamma x gamma y is equal, did I make a mistake there or there as well?
No.
Okay, so this is, yeah, there's some confusion in my notation, but here x, y, and z are in the at this point. So this is equal to distance of gamma of x gamma of z plus distance of gamma of z, gamma of y, yes.
But what is d here? It's the same as I
But this is a general definition. This is a. Yes. This is a general definition for a metric D. Well, the question is to describe the geodesics for this metric IA, and this is the definition of a geodesic for a metric D. One question, for instance, or the first, yes.
There is a term I have seen in the literature, geodetic. G-E-O-D-E-T-I-C. Geodetic.
Ah, geodetic. Yeah, it's the same thing. Yes, I'm sure it's the same thing. The first question is to describe some geodesics. So you want to go from X to Y. You want to join X to Y by a geodesic. The first question is to know whether these geodesics always exist, right? These geodesics always exist. It is known that, you see, I come back, as I said, this is in some sense a generalization of a metric, which is a Poincaré metric defined on this upper half plane. Let me recall that you define the metric which I mentioned, dx squared plus dy squared divided by y squared. This is the metric I recalled for the upper half plane. And then it is a theorem, in fact. It's a fact which you have to prove, that any two points are joined by a geodesic. It's not completely obvious from the definition. In fact, it's not at all obvious when I give you the definition. You have to prove this. The second thing which is well known is that you can describe the geodesics. In fact, I take a point here and another point here, and that the geodesic there's one and only one geodesic which joins them, and this is the arc of circle. The piece of this arc of circle which is perpendicular to the boundary. So this is a geodesic joining them. The arc of circle which is perpendicular to the boundary, there's only one, and it is the unique geodesic joining them. Now here it's more complicated, you know, because it's, the formula, I gave you a formula, and then you have to, so a good thing is to start with examples of open sets which are familiar to you. So you take the upper half plane, and then you define this formula, which is you define a metric by this formula, which is surely not the hyperbolic metric, because the distance is not symmetric. You see, there's no reason why this is symmetric. In fact, it's not symmetric. And then you ask the question: Can you draw the geodesics between two points? First, you take special points, and you add special points which you understand well. For instance, if I consider this if I consider this upper half plane as my subset A, then you want to start with points A and B, which are at the same distance from the boundary. So at least there's some quantity here which is the same for your two points. And then you ask the question, can I draw geodesics between these points? And if yes, can I describe all of them? You may ask the question for two points. You see the distance being non-symmetric, then here you have to be careful about the order of the points. The distance from x to y in general is not equal to the distance from y to x. So if I can find here a geodesic from A to B, is it also a geodesic from B to A, which should be true here? I mean, obviously it should be true because of the symmetry. But then you want to take two points like this, A and B, which are on the same vertical line, and you want to ask the same question: Can I find a geodesic from A to B? Can I find an explicit one? Is it unique? And is it also a geodesic if I go from B to A instead of A to B? I mean, you see this picture I drew here of the image of gamma in my place, when I traverse it in this sense, it will be a geodesic. But when I traverse it in the opposite sense, is it also a geodesic? Then you will try to characterize the points in your space, just in this particular example where the geodesic from A to B is also a geodesic from B to A. Is it only these points which are at the same Euclidean height, or is there something else? And after the geodesics, you see you can do a lot of things. If you understand the geodesics, then instead of taking two points and a geodesic segment joining them, you will take three points. You will take three points, x, y, and z, and study the triple of here a geodesic between x and y, a geodesic between x and z, a geodesic between y and z. And z. Of course, in the right order, you want to deal with this non-symmetric metric. If you don't like non-symmetric metrics, then you just can symmetrize. In this case, this theory sometimes becomes easier, sometimes it becomes more difficult, you know. But sometimes, if you want it to be symmetric, then you just consider these three lines without the orientation. Anyway, when you get three lines, you get what is called a triangle in your space, and you want to understand the geometry of these triangles. And there are several ways to understand the geometry of this triangle. One way is to understand what is called the rough geometry of triangles, which is included in this theory that Besson and Fourcroy will explain to you, which is the Gromov of hyperbolicity. And if you want to understand what happens in the large for these triangles, you see, you want to understand the behavior of triangles with large sides. I call these the sides of my triangle, these geodesics joining them. But other things which are interesting in this example, I never checked this example, but there are other examples of such strangely defined metrics which I worked on. And you want to understand the exact properties of these triangles. So for instance, you want to take midpoints here and study the
the midpoints and these three geodesics, which join the vertices to the midpoints of the opposite vertices, we know in Euclidean geometry that these three geodesics will meet in the same point. But for other geometries which I'm defining like this, by this kind of formula, or by other formulas which I will give you in the sequel, you have also triangles, and you have the same questions. Do these three, in French we call them mediatrices, I don't know in English what is the word, do these three mediatrices always meet in the same point? In general, the answer is no, for this kind of metric, this kind of very general open set A, but just consider the upper half space or some other reasonably studied space like an open disk, or a little bit more general, an ellipse, and a disk, or a triangle, equilateral triangle. I don't know whether the fact that it's equilateral or not will play any role, but you have a collection of spaces on which you can define this kind of metric, and then study the geometry of triangles in these spaces. Other questions which you can ask, and which I will show you on examples, or what are the known results. You see, you have triangles. You have triangles, but you can study also circles. You can study circles. You take a point in your space. And you take a certain positive number r. You take a certain positive number r, and then you define, like, say, the circle. This point I call x. X r. The circle of center x and radius r. This is the set of points y in your space such that, let's talk about this metric here, IA of xy is equal to r. This is the circle of center x and radius r. Of course, I chose this the distance from x to y. I could have taken the distance from y to x. It would have given me something else, because the distance is not symmetric. And we call this, say, s plus. You could also consider s minus of xr. This is your set of y such that IA of yx is equal to r. This is usually called right. Well, I said circle, but in general, I denote by s because it's a sphere. In fact, in higher dimension, it says instead of a circle, we talk about a sphere. This is the right circle, and this is the left circle, or more generally, right sphere centered at x of radius r. And you have a lot of questions about these circles or spheres. The first question is, for this metric, are the spheres connected? This is a topological question. This is not obvious. You have to show that it's connected. If you know a little bit of topology, you want to is the circle here is a circle for this matrix homeomorphic to a familiar circle, or maybe it's even non-compact. Maybe this will be a circle. I don't know, something which the boundary points are accumulation points. I don't know. I never thought about this for this matrix. Okay, so you have these topological properties, and then in specific examples, like in examples where my set A is a circle, like this, the interior of a circle, a disk. Can you draw the circles for this metric? Can you draw the circles for this metric? For instance, it is known, again, I come back to my hyperbolic metric with this strangely defined formula. I mean, the formula which is dS² dx² plus dy squared divided by the distance to the boundary. It is a fact, it is a theorem, in fact. It's something which is very well known, in fact, and you should know this, that the circles, in fact, are Euclidean circles. In fact, it turns out that the circles are Euclidean circles, but you have to prove it. And here I ask the same question for this quasi-semi-hyperbolic matrix. How are the circles? Are there instances where the circles are Euclidean circles? So I think these are good questions, which several metrics, in fact. But let's stick to this semi-hyperbolic. These are questions which do not need any knowledge at all. Just first year mathematics, you know. And you can study these metrics and prove. Maybe you can prove good theorems. Maybe you can prove interesting theorems just because you have some intuition or some idea of how to study this metric. I don't know when I started.
It's over.
It's over, so I did